Audiobook, Simply This Moment. 5 Detachment. 5th of April 2000. When we discuss the teachings of Buddhism, we talk a lot about attachments. This is a word that is often misunderstood and misused by many Buddhists. If we don't understand what the word means, we can get into a lot of trouble and experience confusion. The opposite of attachment is easier to understand. It is called letting go. We always know when letting go is happening because things disappear. We don't know when attachment happens because most of the time we can't see it. The nature of delusion, the core problem of human beings, is to blind us. Delusion, or illusion if you like, is called avijja in Pali, and that delusion and lack of enlightenment is something that we can't see. It's a blind spot inside us, but we don't know we are blind. The road to suffering. The big problem of avijja or delusion is that a person who is deluded always thinks they are right. That is the reason there are so many different ideas and opinions in this world. We can't see that that is not the correct way to look at things. However, there is one way that we can find out what delusion is. Delusion is that which leads to suffering. It's that which leads to problems and difficulties. Wisdom is that which leads to the end of suffering and difficulties. In the same way, attachment, which is the result of delusion, is that which causes suffering, pain and difficulty in our lives. It's detachment and letting go that frees us and leads to us to happiness, peace and contentment. This is the best way to understand the meaning of these terms. If whatever is happening in our life is causing suffering or discomfort, it's because of a lack of contentment, which is there for the taking. It means that we're not seeing something. We need to have at least enough wisdom and faith to challenge ourselves. So often, it's the sense of self, the sense of ego, the sense of pride born of that ego, which feeds the delusion, I can't be wrong, I'm right. No one else understands. Only me. It's one's self that feeds the attachments. This is right. This is what I want to do. This is the correct way. This is the right idea. This delusion is attachment to views. So often we just can't see that, because we think we have the right view. It's very hard for a human being to know they are wrong. In fact, no one thinks they are wrong. We all think we are right. That's the problem. Even though in a monastery, there can be 30 different people, everyone thinks they know the Dhamma. But everyone can't know the Dhamma if they've all got different ideas. This is where one needs a bit of humility, a bit of faith or confidence in the teachings of the Buddha. Fortunately, the teachings of the Buddha are very clear. They have been well preserved and are reasonably well translated. So we can actually look at those teachings for ourselves. But even here, we've got to be very careful because of the way delusion works. We can read into some of those teachings things that aren't even there in the translations. For example, attachment. We shouldn't be attached. We shouldn't even be attached to meditation. We shouldn't be attached to being a monk. We shouldn't be attached to anything. We shouldn't be attached to eating or not eating. We shouldn't even be attached to sleeping. So if that's the case, don't sleep tonight. This gets ridiculous and stupid, doesn't it? However, people can read into it whatever they wish. Some lay Buddhists even say they shouldn't be attached to the precepts. But they don't say they shouldn't be attached to their wives and children, to their coffee or whatever else it is that serves their sensory gratification. They are just using attachment to fulfill their sensory desires and to criticize others who challenge them. They are just using their sensory desires in an unfair way. Grounded in illusion and aim to protect their comfort, aim to protect the cravings and attachments that are binding them to this world of samsara. If you want to check out these teachings of the Buddha, you need to have intellectual honesty, or at least a sense of integrity, to be able to see these teachings for what they are. You have to see the whole of the teachings, not just some parts, without adding anything to them or taking anything away. Don't just choose some very obscure passages that support your ideas. Don't read so much into one or two hard to translate obscure passages and ignore the very great mass of very clear and very precise, repeated teachings, which you find throughout the Buddhist scriptures. At least that much should give you a sense of understanding what the Buddha actually taught. For those of you who have gone so far as to become monks, you should have confidence and faith in what the Buddha taught, and you should have some confidence and faith in those monks who have been practicing for much longer than you. That's the reason we have Nisaya, support, or depending upon another. That's so important in the practice, because we cannot just depend upon ourselves. Personal views. We cannot become enlightened all by ourselves. Only a Buddha can do that. For that reason, we need the help of other people. We can see how this is so, because everyone has their own ideas and we cling to those ideas tenaciously. We argue with the teacher. We even argue with the Buddha, because everyone else is wrong except us. I'm the only one who really understands. It's important to understand that unless you've had an experience of enlightenment, unless you are a stream winner, unless you are an Arya, you should always take it as a given that you are still deluded. If one is a Pathujjana, an ordinary person, then avijja is still there and one hasn't yet seen the Dhamma. There is still something missing. So, one should have the humility to trust the teachings of the Buddha, the real Dhamma. That's the only way we can have a hope of overcoming the attachments to our own personal views. That attachment to one's own personal views is probably one of the strongest, fiercest, most tenacious, and most dukkha-producing of all the attachments. Attachment to views stops one from even getting on the path leading to the ending of suffering. People in this world are often so convinced of their own views that they never challenge them at all. This creates so much suffering for themselves and others. Sometimes we can see exactly what people are doing. As the Buddha said in a simile that he gave, we see them acting like a man walking on a path leading into a pit of burning coals. If he keeps on walking in that direction, you know he will end up in the blazing pit of coals, causing suffering or even death. You can tell him not to go in that direction, to go in another direction instead, but he just won't listen. He won't change his view that this is the right way to go. I know this is a big problem with human beings. It's caused either through a lack of wisdom or a lack of faith. Wisdom and faith are two of the five indriyas, spiritual qualities that are also spiritual powers. Sometimes they are translated as controlling faculties because they are so important on the path to enlightenment. The five indriyas are faith, energy, mindfulness, samadhi, and wisdom. If one hasn't enough of these qualities, one will always be on the wrong path, and one won't be even getting close to Nibbana. One won't even be getting close to the door through which these great insight experiences can be found. It is going in the wrong direction altogether. If one hasn't got wisdom, one needs to have a lot of faith. The trouble is most people already think they've got lots of wisdom, and that leads them to think they don't need faith. They think and that's the problem. One knows one has wisdom if the path is developing. One needs not just the ability to keep virtuous conduct, the ability to restrain the mind, and the ability to calm the mind, but also the ability to eradicate the five hindrances, the ability to get into a jhana, and the ability to be equanimous and have clear insights coming up throughout the day. All of these things are signs that your wisdom is developing and the path is manifesting. If those things aren't happening, it means our wisdom isn't strong enough. Nathi Janam Apanasa, Pana Nathi Ajayato, DHP 372, there is no jhana in one who lacks wisdom, nor is there wisdom in one who lacks jhana. These two depend upon each other. So don't think that you are wise if you can't get into deep meditation. There is no wisdom without jhana. That humbles one. It humbles one to say, look, there are things in here that I just don't understand, that I just don't see. Maybe I have to trust someone else. Maybe I really can trust the teacher and have faith in him. At the very least, I can trust what the Buddha said in the suttas. The clear teachings that we see in the suttas show us what we should be doing to overcome our attachments. The attachments that we have are the attachments to our views, attachments to the sensory world of the five senses, attachments to our business or to our projects, attachments to our thoughts and attachments to our emotions. All these attachments have to be let go of and abandoned. Uncovering the attachments. The practice of abandoning the attachments is what we do when we sit or walk in meditation, and also when we do anything else in this monastery. My training as a young monk in Thailand was all about uncovering the attachments that I had. I could see the coarser attachments, so I could abandon them and let them go because I could see that they were causing suffering. When Ajahn Chah was building the main hall at Wat Pa Phong, where all the monks training under Ajahn Chah were ordained, some monks here were ordained in that hall at Wat Pa Phong. I was staying at Wat Pananashat. But because they needed more workers to help at Wat Pa Phong, we were all called over there for a week. There was a big mound of earth raised by the monks, on which the ordination hall was going to be built. No earth moving machinery was available, so all the work was done with what they call bungees, hoes, and wheelbarrows. After making the mound, there was a lot of earth left over, and because it was an eyesore, Ajahn Chah told us to move it around to the side. We spent a couple of days moving it to the side. Not just for 1 or 2 hours, but from when the meal finished at about 9 o'clock in the morning, with hardly time to brush your teeth, just moving wheelbarrows until 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night. Because we had faith in Ajahn Chah, we did that. When it got dark, the kerosene lanterns were brought out so that we could see where we were going. We worked until 10 o'clock at night, and then we had showers in cold water and rested. It took 2 or 3 days to move the earth. When it was finished, Ajahn Chah went off to another monastery for a few days, and Ajahn Liam, the second monk, he is now the abbot at Wat Pa Phong, came along and said, no, that's not in the right place. Move the earth. Again, we worked long hours for 2 or 3 days, moving that big pile of earth to another place. You can imagine how we felt as Westerners when Ajahn Chah came back after 3 days and said, what did you move it over there for? I told you to move it over here. So we had to move it all back again. That was really a wonderful experience, because it actually taught me something. It taught me that I could suffer if I wanted to, or I could just accept it out of faith in Ajahn Chah. I could say, these Thai monks are stupid. Why can't they understand or make a decision? This is a stupid way of doing things. Why can't they decide where to put the earth? I never became a monk to shift earth for 12 hours a day. That's what I went to university to escape. I thought that if you go to university, you don't have to do that sort of work anymore. You can just spend your time telling others what to do. I even thought that when you become an abbot, you are the boss, and you don't have to work so hard. What a joke. What it taught me to say was, look, if this is causing suffering, if it's dukkha to have to move all this earth, It's not the earth that is the cause of the suffering. It's not a John Chen, a John Liam, who are the cause of suffering. It must be some delusions, some attachments or some craving inside me that is the cause of the suffering. This is what a John Cha kept on pointing at. The first noble truth is that dukkha is not caused by work. Dukkha is not caused by mosquitoes. Dukkha is not caused by heat or by cold. Dukkha is caused by craving. That's the fundamental teaching of the Buddha. That taught me to look for the cause of suffering elsewhere, not in the externals, but in me, in my attitude, in my craving, in my attachment, in my delusions. Some people just lost it altogether and said, well, if this is monastic life, it's not for me. They looked at monastic life as being the cause of suffering, or the work as being the cause of suffering, or the hierarchy as being the cause of suffering. Everyone in this monastery should know the delusion of that view. We learned something through that experience. We learned that if something causes suffering, there must be a wrong attitude. I looked at some of the other monks and they were very happy to move that earth. They weren't just monks who liked working, some of them were great meditators. People like a John Liam could work all day and meditate all night. I sometimes wondered how they could do this, but they could do it and they did do it. You read in the suttas about monks working. That is all part of our duties. This is how we realize that it's not the work that is suffering, it is one's attachment to something. It is one's craving for something and one's delusion that is the cause of suffering. The Dhamma talk, the chanting, the mood or whatever else it is, these aren't the cause of suffering. In fact, in the whole of Sasara, this monastery is probably one of the most comfortable places to exist. As far as external situations are concerned, you have very little to be concerned or worried about. You have very few problems to deal with, and it's so comfortable in this monastery. Where else in the world can you live like this? There were days, a long while ago, when you could live on the dole, but now I am told you have to work at the very minimum 17 hours per week to get the dole. Here you only have to work 10 hours to get your food. That's almost half. And that's not counting the retreats and everything else we do. If there is any suffering caused by the monastic lifestyle, it's due to your attachments to the craving inside you. You should look at that and find out what it is. You know, you have gained some insight and uncovered that attachment and wrong view if you can work and be peaceful. But if you cannot work and be peaceful, if you cannot move earth all day and be peaceful, you will never be free from suffering. If you can live in this monastery or any other monastery, and it's just the same for you, then you understand something about the nature of the mind, the nature of freedom, the nature of attachments and the nature of letting go. Whatever food you eat, whatever you're called upon to do, it doesn't matter. Give this moment joy. There is a teaching in the suttas where a monk says, it's too hot to meditate. It's too cold to meditate. It's too early to meditate. It's too late to meditate. Monks like that will never gain liberation from suffering. Whether it's hot, whether it's cold, whether it's late, doesn't matter, just meditate now. Whether I'm tired or whether I'm energetic, it doesn't matter, just now I'm meditating. This is how I was trained, and it is a training that I'd like to share with you, so that you will be able to develop a mind that is independent of the external situations and circumstances. A mind that really can let go of the world and let go of the body. That's why the great forest teachers, the ones who are enlightened and give teachings to create other enlightened monks, always emphasize meditation on the body, mindfulness on the body. Separate the mind from all those bodily feelings that can so easily create tiredness, pain, heat, cold, or sometimes even comfort. See these feelings as they are, a play on that world. Outside. If one is too attached to the body, then when it's hot, the mind is hot too. When it's cold, the mind is just freezing. When you're tired, the mind is tired. When you're energetic, the mind is restless. Sometimes there is just too much of a connection between the body and the mind, and so when the world swings one way, the mind swings with it. We cannot control the world outside. We've been trying to do that for years. I thought that if I were the abbot of a monastery, I could control the situation in the monastery. I can't. I admit to you in all honesty that the monastery is out of control. One can guide it, one can incline it in a certain direction, but basically it's out of control. The monastery goes its own way according to the Dhamma. We understand that we cannot control the outside world. We can't even control our own bodies, let alone the monastery or other people's bodies. But we can let go. Can you control your own body and get rid of all the aches and the pains? You can't do that. But often, because of our delusion and our attachments, because we think we possess this body and this world, we get in there and try to control, change, and manipulate things. We are always thinking of ways to get our own way. That's the cause of suffering in this monastery. Take it as it is, especially until you get peace in your mind. At this moment, why can't you accept it as it is? The moment is here. It's come. You can't change it. Maybe the next moment might be different, but this moment is just like this. This is why the whole path of Buddhism is to let go of trying to change this moment and instead develop a sense of contentment. In other words, let this moment be. The only way you can let the moment be and not try and change it and control it is to find joy in the monastic life. Find joy in your duties. The only way I can carry on talking like this is to actually put happiness into it, to give it meaning, to give it value. The only way I can work so hard is to give my work value and meaning, to give it joy. That's the only way I can meditate, by giving this moment joy and energy. This is a practice that I have been doing for many years. Realizing that I cannot do just what I want to do, I do what I have to do. I make that happy, I give that joy. I invest joy in whatever I am doing. That's been a training, not something that I was born with, but something that I have trained myself to do. Give joy to whatever you have to do, whether it's moving bricks or it's pushing a wheelbarrow, giving a talk or talking to some foolish person who rings up late at night, whatever it is, put joy into it. Because that joy goes straight against the fault-finding mind, the controlling mind, the negative mind that causes so much attachment and so much suffering. Whatever we're doing, when we develop joy in the mind, we're going in the opposite direction to habit. It's so easy to follow our habits of mind and get upset, get depressed, or give in to tiredness. I am reminded of Ajahn Chah with the presence here of Ajahn Anek, one of Ajahn Chah's senior disciples. To just listen to him talk in Thai brings back all the old memories of Ajahn Chah's teaching. Ajahn Chah said, "Don't follow the moods in your mind. If a mood comes up, don't get involved in it. Don't follow. Don't build it up. Don't get attached to it. In other words, just let it burn itself out. We might have anger, but at least we're not going to push that wheelbarrow along and build the anger up. If we get tired, that is just bodily tired, that's all. If we get depressed, don't sink into that depression. It's just a pit and it gives us so much suffering. Don't get into that depression. Instead, put joy into the mind. Don't believe in those moods. When we believe in those moods, we get attached to them. We believe we are upset. We believe we're tired or depressed. Who is upset? who is tired and who is depressed. Once we can actually detach from these moods, they don't occur. Once there is not an I, how can there be someone who is upset, someone who is depressed, or someone who is angry? Depressed or someone who is angry? Depressed or someone who is angry?